Good morning, church. It is a joy to be in worship with you this morning. My name is Grace Han. I'm the pastor here at Trinity, and whether this is your first time joining us or your 100,000th time, whatever big number you can think of, we are glad to be in worship with you today. This morning, we are blessed to welcome Reverend Dr. Yutha Harbin Cromwell to the pulpit. She is going to be preaching about doing our part, about what is possible if we are willing to partner with God as God calls us to be God's ministry partners. We're going to be so blessed by Yutha's message today, and we're so blessed to have her bringing that word today. So as we continue in worship, I want to invite you to join me in the call to worship. The response is, in partnering with God, we worship. In partnering with God, we worship. Let us join together in the call to worship. We want to live a significant life. In partnering with God, we worship. God blesses each of us with various gifts. In partnering with God, we worship. As children of God, we share our gifts in community. In partnering with God, we worship. We walk in faith that God is at work in our midst. In partnering with God, we worship. Amen. Let us join together in our opening hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. We begin by sharing in a prayer of confession and pardon that brings us into right relationship before God and with one another. So I invite you to join me in that prayer of confession you'll see printed in your bulletins. Merciful God, We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have failed to recognize your image in our neighbor. We have failed to choose to advocate for your justice. And we have failed to create community which includes all and gives to all equal access to your abundant life. Forgive us, we pray. Heal us, we pray. Friends, hear this good news. God's gift of grace in Jesus Christ forgives us and sets us free to live full human lives in community. May we go forth confident of the grace to see with new eyes beyond prejudice, to imagine with renewed fervor justice and mercy for all, and to create with a new will a community where all are given access to God's abundant life. Glory be to God. Amen. At this time, we invite you to share the peace with one another. There's two ways that we invite you to do that. The first is to register your attendance with us. We ask you to do this. One, we would love to know that you are worshiping with us. I would love to know that you're worshiping with us. It's a way for us to be in touch with you. And the second is so that we can check in on you. We would love to know that how you are doing and how you're surviving this strange season that we are living in. In the registration, you can also add if you have prayer requests or if you'd like to be added to our prayer chain, or if you'd like to receive alerts by text, all of these ways to be connected. So we encourage you to do that. We also invite you to comment below in the chat feature. You'll just say that you're here. It's a way for us to interact during our worship service. So let's pass the peace with one another. Children to pay attention a little bit more. We are going to join together for our children's time. And today for our children's time, I want to tell you a story about a boy with five loaves and two fishes. You might have heard this story before. This is one of the stories of Jesus's miracles, and I think this is one of the most incredible stories. So one time when Jesus was teaching, he was teaching in a countryside. And as he was preaching, more and more people were hearing his message and were excited by the message. So they were all gathering around him. And soon, wouldn't you believe it, the whole countryside was filled with people who wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. And Jesus was preaching and the people were staying. And after a while, they had been there for a few hours, and the disciples realized the people are going to be hungry. Something like sometimes when we're watching church, and by the end of church, you're probably a little bit hungry, right? So the disciples were worried about all the people that were here and how they were going to feed all these people. People would get hangry. I don't know if you know what hangry is. Hangry is when you get so hungry that you become angry. Have you ever had that experience? We've had that experience in our family a few times. The disciples were worried that the people were going to get hangry. So they went to Jesus and they said, you know what, Jesus, we should send the people home so that they can go home to their own homes and eat. There's no way we could feed all these people. And as they were figuring out what they should do, all of a sudden, there was this little boy. And the little boy had five little barley loaves and two fish. It was only enough, really, to feed one little boy. But one of the disciples said, there's this little boy with some food. And the disciples said, oh, that's not going to be enough food for anybody. But Jesus said, bring this little boy to me. And Jesus brought this little boy, and he took this lunch, and he gave thanks to God for this meal. And then, you know what he did? he told the disciples, distribute the food. And the disciples are like, what are you talking about, Jesus? There's not enough food even for 1.5 people. But Jesus said, give them something to eat. So the disciples started passing out the food, the bread and the fish. And do you know what happened? They had enough to feed all of those people in the countryside. In fact, they had leftovers. They had 12 baskets left over. And the disciples couldn't believe this miracle that Jesus had done, that he had taken this one lunch and been able to feed all of the people. See, this is something that's hard sometimes for us to believe, but that's exactly the kind of thing that God does. God takes our nothing, our small thing, and makes it enough for everyone. And that is the blessing that we find today. Let me say a prayer for us. Gracious God, help us remember that you can take the small gifts that we bring and make them enough to feed the whole world. Help us remember that the gifts that you have given to us can be used to bless so many people. We pray that we can remember your call to go and be your hands and feet in our world. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we come to our time of morning prayer. We want to remind you that if you're not already receiving our prayer chain email, that you can sign up to receive it. This is a way that we can share prayer concerns with one another and to be in prayer together as a congregation. Today, as I lift up petitions, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and you are invited to respond, hear our prayers. Let us pray together. God, we thank you that you have called us your ministry partners. We thank you that you have entrusted us and gifted us with the ability to be your hands and feet. And we pray that we can live into the fullness of those gifts, that we won't take them for granted or bury them or put them aside, but instead we will use them to build for your kingdom. God, we confess that we have too often lost sight of your call in our lives. We have gotten distracted by our own ambitions. We have turned away from your people and mission. We seek your forgiveness. We pray that we will remember the responsibility that comes in being ministry partners with you. God, we pray this day for all those who suffer, for those who are hungry and thirsty, for those who mourn and grieve, for those who are tired and find life burdensome, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we pray for peace in our world, for nations who are at war, for people who suffer because of violence, for those who live in the midst of instability and insecurity, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, as this pandemic continues, we pray for your healing. We pray for those who have been affected, for those who are sick with the COVID-19, for caretakers, medical professionals, doctors, nurses, and other staff, for those who are afraid and lonely, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we pray for our church. Even though we are separated from one another physically, we pray for your spirit to unite us. We pray especially for those who long to be together, for those who work tirelessly in the last few months to find creative ways to be together, for those who have worked behind the scenes. We pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we lift up all of these prayers to you, whether they have been spoken out loud or they remain still in our hearts. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to say a special word of thank you to Rachel King, who has been bringing us beautiful music this morning. We have been just blessed with all of the wonderful talent we have in our church to bring quality music every single Sunday. So we are so blessed by that. Our first scripture for today, let me get the stand right here. Our first scripture today comes from Exodus chapter 1, verses 8 to 17. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard work and mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, and they let the boys live. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand as you're able for the reading of the gospel. We have been joking that it's a chance for you to take a little stretch break before the sermon. So we invite you to stand as you're able. Our gospel reading comes from John chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near, and when he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat? He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of the disciples, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people? And Jesus said, Make the people sit down. Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, Gather up the fragments left over so nothing may be lost. So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Before I introduce our guest preacher for today, I just want to make a quick announcement. This week, you should have received an email from our Healthy Church team, which has been the group in our church that's been looking at plans for what in-person gatherings are going to look like at Trinity. There were 2 main takeaways that email said that I just want to highlight. The first is that we have been approved to host some limited in-person gatherings, and starting this coming Wednesday, August 5th, we are going to be holding prayer and communion services in our courtyard, which is this grassy area between the church and the parsonage. We're asking you to sign up in advance to register. We're capping each service to 30 individuals just so we can ensure proper social distancing. And we're going to ask you to fill out a health acknowledgement form and be masked and be social distance. We have pre-filled cups and wafers that are individually wrapped and sealed so that, we want to just take every precaution to make sure people are safe. The second takeaway from that email was that at this time, the Healthy Church team is recommending that our Sunday worship remain online only for the time being. In the email, we explained that we're doing this for 2 reasons. The first is to ensure the safety of all, and moving worship inside at this time isn't something that we're completely comfortable with yet. In addition, we wanted to maintain a high quality of worship and worship experience. And unfortunately, if we had people worshiping in the sanctuary, it would limit what we could and couldn't do. It would diminish our worship experience together. We wouldn't be able to sing together. We don't have to be masked, including the preacher. So our recommendation at this time is to keep Sunday worship online only. Instead, what we want to do as we move into the fall is focus on how we can have more small group gatherings, either virtually or online, finding alternative and creative ways for us to be in community together. These are plans that we're obviously revisiting as we know more, as we learn more, and hopefully we look forward to the time when we can all gather in the sanctuary together to worship. But in the meanwhile, we hope that you will find ways to get a little bit more connected with us.
This morning, we are blessed to welcome a familiar face to our pulpit, the Reverend Dr. Yutha Hardman Cromwell, who really needs no introduction here. Dr. Yutha is a ordained elder in the United Methodist Church. She has been a professor at Wesley Seminary for many, many years. She's been a part of our church for 30 plus years, and we are so blessed to have her bring the word today. And so, without further ado, I'm going to welcome Yutha to the pulpit.
Good morning, sisters and brothers. I am delighted to have the opportunity to speak with you this morning and give our pastor a break. Doing our part, let us pray. So here we are, Lord, your men and women, boys and girls, and we come because we always need a word from you. And so we ask that as we are together in worship this day, that your word might be spoken, that we might have ears to hear your word, and that as we go forth after this time of worship, that we will live your word in the world. Oh God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, set my heart aflame with faith, hope, and love, that I might share your gospel with your children in ways that they can understand. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Doing our part. Some of us at Trinity have participated in a four-week Bible study on social justice led by our own Hannah. We looked at homelessness, food insecurity, trans and intersex issues, and racism and criminal justice. If you were not a part of it, you missed a very enlightening and challenging opportunity. At the end of our study, Hannah offered us a list of roles needed for social justice to be realized in our lives, our church, our nation, our world. Each of these roles can contribute to bringing about social justice, but no one person can fill them all. It takes a variety of persons using the gifts, opportunities, resources, experiences, and the like to fill a needed role, every person doing their part, the part that they can do. The thing is that is true of any goal we humans undertake to achieve. But think of it, what we do or not do contributes to or inhibits any goal, any task that is before us. When a goal is reached, we often celebrate the end product with little thought of all the little pieces, all the contributing actions, the parts done that brings the goal into reality. I think that we all would agree that the division in our nation is not what we would like. The question before us is, what part will each of us play that counters that division? It is a question that each of us must answer out of our individual uniqueness, gifts, experiences, resources, opportunities, and the like. The focus in our teaching and preaching about the feeding of the 5,000 plus women and children is usually on the miracle that Jesus performs with the 5 loaves and 2 fish. But I want us to focus today on others in this story. The disciples who are challenged by Jesus about feeding 5,000 people, women and children beside. The boy who is not even counted among the 5,000, who gives up his lunch of 5 loaves and 5 fish, clearly a lunch that seems inadequate to feed 5,000 people. And the mother, not even present to be counted in the 5,000, who probably packed that lunch of 5 loaves and 2 fish. None of them, disciples, boy, and mother, was able to meet the need individually. Unlike Jesus, each of them is limited in their ability to feed 5,000 women and children besides. but they all participated in the feeding of the 5,000. Without them, each doing their part, the people would not have been fed. Each of them is a partner in the miracle that unfolded. This story that opens John 6 finds Jesus, his disciples, and a crowd of people in a wilderness. And bread was a staple of life for them, and there was no banana bread or Subway or Wendy's to grab a quick meal. They had been spiritually fed, but they also had a physical need at the end of a long day. No food in sight. They were having an experience of food insecurity. Given what is going on around us in our world, in our nation, and in the United Methodist Church, all of us have felt in the last few months that we are living in a wilderness, feeling insecure and uncertain about the future. Our usual confidence and feelings of security may be shattered. Even if we are not experiencing or fearing experiencing homelessness, social or criminal injustice, or problems because of our gender and sexuality, we may find ourselves feeling unusually vulnerable, however, wondering what we could possibly do to make a difference in the midst of the chaos. In life, we often come face to face with our limitations. We are often sized up and sorted out by others or even ourselves, labeled unfit, unprepared, not smart enough, not white enough, not male enough, not straight enough, not rich enough, not connected enough, not compliant enough, not experienced enough. Inadequate, worthless, invisible. None of us is perfect. Not one of us has all the gifts needed for any situation or the need that we may face. We all have limitations. That is why God created us to live in community. We need each other. In community, we are greater than the sum of all that we are individually. All of our gifts and the parts that we can play are needed. The crowd followed Jesus to that wilderness, hungering for more spiritually, and they hungered physically. Jesus knew they needed to be fed physically. Jesus challenges the disciples to take care of that. The disciples are aware of their limitations. When we begin to respond to a situation focusing on our lack, our thinking puts limitations on the possibilities. That limits our vision. We can't see all the various parts and roles that are already there to be accessed and used. We can't always imagine that everyone doing the part that they can will result the situation being successfully addressed. But God specializes in generous abundance, even as we often think in terms of deficit. We can't. We don't have. In this spiritual miracle story, Jesus links the caring of God with the caring responsibility of those who have faith in God for doing their part in the care of others. Once we step out in faith, God meets us much more than halfway. All we need to do is take the resources we have and watch God transform them into abundance. If we will just do the part we can see before us. Now, I want you to remember that other story from years ago, before the scene in the wilderness. You heard it read in the scriptures this morning. The midwives have no idea that their defiance of Pharaoh's order to kill the boy babies would mean that Moses was saved to be called to lead the slaves out of Egypt. Moses' mother and sister and Pharaoh's daughter have no idea that this baby would be the one to lead the slaves out of Egypt. What each of them believed was that these babies deserved to live. Each one did what she could to keep them alive, and Moses lived to lead the slaves out of slavery into freedom. When in a challenging situation, we easily identify our inadequacies, but remember God's surprising power. Ephesians 3:20 reminds us that God can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Over and over again, the scriptures and our lives remind us that God can use anyone for God's purposes. Now, we may never know what actually happened that enabled 5,000 women and children besides to be fed in that wilderness experience. Perhaps Jesus kept giving the fish and bread and giving the fish and bread until everyone had enough. Or there may have been others in the crowd besides the boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish who had food but did not bring it out at first. Perhaps when they saw the child, one standing before them but without standing in the community, give up what he had to eat. And perhaps they took out their food. They may have been inspired by the boy giving up his part so that all might eat. Imagine this. The people are there, all hungry, but all possessing a little bit with them to eat. They are hiding their snack for fear that others will want it. But as the 5 loaves and 2 fish are passed among them, they each put in a portion of what he or she brought, resulting in abundance, in excess. The example of the boy with his little lunch releasing them from their fear of inadequacy and overcoming their self-centered concern so that they shared the little they had so that it became more than what was needed. Abundance. Just imagine. We can do the same in the situations that challenge our capabilities. Our greatest ability is our availability. When we do what is right in the moment, together we become greater than the sum of our parts. Individually, we are incomplete and inadequate, but together there is power to do what is needed. Suppose the boy's mother decided not to fix him a lunch, thinking there would be food there. Suppose the boy had not given up his lunch, thinking this is not enough to share. Suppose the disciples had cased up the situation and had not passed out the food among the people. Suppose the midwives had not defied Pharaoh's order to kill the boy babies because they feared for their lives, a reasonable fear. Suppose Moses' mother had not put him into the river in the basket and his sister had not watched over him because they could not figure out how doing so would save Moses' life. Suppose Pharaoh's daughter had not taken the child into her care because the baby was not her responsibility. You get the idea. Would the miracle of the feeding happen, giving those 5,000 plus women and children a witness of the power of Jesus and how God provides in miraculous, abundant ways? Or would Moses have been alive to experience God's commission to lead the Hebrew children out of oppression and into the promised land? Each player in the events, more than I have identified, did their part, opening them to partnering with God without even knowing how. Just doing what they were led or inspired to do affected the future. 2 Sundays ago, Pastor Grace encouraged us to love in ways that would change the future. These 2 stories we have looked at today are illustrations of how individual choices affected the future, a future that we see, but they did not. What we do with the opportunities we have, with the urges and callings we experience, with the gifts and talents and resources we have, plays a part in shaping the future. Our decisions, our actions, our interactions mean something, even when we can't see what they mean for the larger picture of the future. John Lewis, who died as a warrior for justice, was known to encourage others by saying, "Keep on getting into good trouble," something he did for over 60 years. He did not live to see how his courageous giving of his life for justice in the United States would come to full fruition, but he did his part anyway. That is what Sifra and Pua did. They took the risk of defying Pharaoh to save the boy babies, doing what was right. They risked getting into good trouble, but probably never knew the part they played in saving Moses' life. If we offer God all that we are, however humble, small, and ridiculously inadequate it seems, God will work wonders with it. In divine humility, God uses us, calls us, challenges us to do our part. If we do what we understand to be right and in accordance with God's will and way, we can have an impact far beyond what we could possibly imagine. We too might have a part in saving the life of a deliverer, like Shifra and Pua, Moses' mother and sister and Pharaoh's daughter. We too might find a part to play, like the disciples' mother and the boy, that leads to meeting the spiritual or physical or justice needs of a community, a nation, a world. In each of these stories, the persons who partnered with God were not leaders in their communities. They were ordinary people. They were those unlikely diverse disciples, a boy and women. Some of them were not even considered to be significant enough to be counted. Marginalized people, ordinary people, people like you and like me, made a difference in the course of history. They may not have seen themselves as partners with God, but they were. They were because they did what was right in the moment. We are living in a wilderness time. It is a pivotal time in the world in which we live. It is serious business. Our lives and how we use them are being challenged. What is our part? Humanity needs us to do it. Let us examine ourselves. Do we hold back what we have to offer? Do we think of things we can do or not do, or refuse to think in terms of possibilities because what we have to offer isn't big enough, isn't unique or impressive enough, it's too ordinary, it's not what we used to be able to do, it seems so inadequate for the need? God has given humanity all we need to be a healthy, faithful community, all created in the image of God. Every gift is vital. Every difference is vital. It is not the gift that validates our humanity, but what we do with our gifts, playing our part, that counts. We are called to be partners with God. Each of us must look around us, searching our hearts. Do we see a need? Will we do what we can to fill it? God can take a little and make it into a future of blessing and abundance, a future we may never even see. Each of us is deciding every minute, every day, all the time, if we will be partners in God's plan. We can make a positive difference in the future, partnering with God, doing what is right, or not. Let us pray. Gracious God, let your will for us all be known. Let all be partners in shaping the future with a faith and actions that quarrel with the present for the sake of what yet might be. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Yutha, for bringing us that powerful word to remind us of what it means to do our part. As we continue in our worship, we come to the time where we give of our tithes and offerings, where we have a chance to respond to the blessings that God has placed in our lives by giving back a portion of those gifts up to God.
If you aren't already doing so, we want to encourage you to give online. You can do that with the Giving tab on our website or through text or set it up through your own system. We want to thank you for those who have been giving. This has been a way for us to plan in a very uncertain time. And many of these gifts have been used to support and encourage others in our community. Our missions team has been very active partnering with organizations right here in Alexandria to meet the needs of so many at this time. And we want to thank you for your generosity. I'm going to leave just a few minutes for us to give our offering, and then I'll close this time with a prayer. Let us pray together. All good gifts come from you, dear Lord, and from these riches we bring this offering. Help us to use it for the furtherance of your purpose in this place and for the benefit of those in need. Amen. Let us join together in our closing hymn, I Sing a Song of the Saints of God. You'll see the link for how to access that below. Let us pray together. God, may we go forth from this place knowing that we are called your partners in ministry. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen.